It's the Andy Thompson Show on ESPN 97.7.
All right, Larry, let's go. What do you got in the sport hall brought to you by Ideal Home and Auto Paint? Bring it on, brother.
The sport hall.
Sports, 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 sports.
2-minute drill.
1-0 delivery. Hammered down the line in right field, and it is fair and slides into third for an RBI triple.
Presented by Ideal Home and Auto Paint.
Region Rush game spotlight, Larry. Great battle last night at Pineview. Nash Schroeder pitched 5 innings, only gave up 1 earned run. Poe Campbell went 3 for 3 with 2 doubles. Andrew Shakespeare went 2 for 3, smoked the ball every time he was up. But Crimson had a huge 4th inning, 2-out rally. And then with the game tied at 6 in the top of the 7th inning, Trey Evans hit one to the moon to give Crimson the win. Here's Trey.
I was just trying to put a barrel on the ball. Like, I was struggling earlier in the game. I just couldn't find the barrel, so I was just trying to get the barrel out there and just do something for the team.
And then just tell me about the win in a, you know, back and forth game tonight here at Pineview.
Oh yeah, it was a great win.
All right, the Gatorade.
Thank you, guys, man.
Gatorade bathed him there. Trey Evans, 2-run shot in the top of the 7th to get Crimson the win. It was a devastating loss for Pineview because Nash pitched a really good game. They had an error in the 4th that changed the whole 3 runs scored on it. And so I felt bad for Pineview because Nash hit well. He had 2 hits. One, I think, counted. It should have been an RBI single or a 2-RBI single for Schroeder. They counted it as an error. Shakespeare hit the ball really well, and Poe Campbell was 3 for 3. That kid's a 9th grader, Larry. When I was in 9th grade, I was still in coach pitch. This kid's playing varsity ball and hitting like 440 or something. It's fantastic. Crimson gets the win 8-6, and that's going to be another great game on Friday. Some weird calls in that game. Some weird things happen in that game. And I think Coach Walker and Coach Abbott would say the same. There were a couple of deep fly balls that I thought were gone that Cisneros made a play out in left. He made a couple plays, I think, out in left. But the best defensive play last night was McKay Wright for Crimson in right field. A little flare hit. I'm like, there's no way kid's going to get to this ball. It's going to drop in for a hit. And maybe, I can't remember if there was a runner on base, Larry, but McKay laid out for it. He looked like a young Roberto Clemente out there in right field making a play. That was probably the most spectacular defensive play of the game, but Trey Evans going deep. I think he's got, dang it, Larry, look up. Is that, was that his 5th home run? Can you look that up?
Yes.
For Trey Evans, who's been one of the best hitters in Region 9 for the last 3 years. I mean, if you look at that matchup with Trey Evans at Crimson, and then you've got Shakespeare at Pineview and Kyson Millen and Nash, that's a heck of a class. You know, all those kids that have been playing since starting since they were sophomores, right? And there's probably more on Crimson. So big win for Coach Abbott and Crimson Cliffs. Dixie beat Hurricane 10-0, and Snow Canyon beat Cedar 16-0 without hitting a home run, I don't think. I think it was all, everybody had an RBI in that game for Snow Canyon. But no bombs, I don't think. All right, let's go to Katie for our first hour look at the National News Desk. What do you got for us, Katie?
Thanks, guys. This show is like watching the CBI tournament. From the Sport Hole National News Center on Bluff Street, I'm Katie Rosen. John Calipari officially was named the head coach of Arkansas's men's basketball program, and the Hall of Famer will be making less with the Razorbacks than he did at Kentucky. Quote, it's great to be among a new group of rednecks who I hope won't send death threats to my family when we lose in the first round to a Division III liberal arts college next season. NBA Commissioner Adam Silver said Wednesday afternoon that Toronto Raptors forward Jonte Parker could be banned for life for betting on himself in NBA games. It was my translator, said Jonte. As if that joke hasn't been made yet. Live Golf League CEO Greg Norman was spotted on the grounds of Augusta National on Wednesday ahead of the 88th playing of the Masters. He was in the trees talking to Shooter McGavin about how to kidnap Rory McIlroy. Today's Sport Hole National News is brought to you by Lawrence's mom. From the Sport Hole National News Center on Bluff Street, I'm Katie Rosen, ESPN 97.7.
Thank you, Katie.
You likey.
All right, do you likey? The Athletic's Ian Mendez's article titled "Why Utah Jazz Owner Ryan Smith is Hell-Bent on Bringing an NHL Team to Salt Lake City." Go ahead, Sambo, if you got a quote from that article. Does Sambo have a quote, Larry?
Yes.
People who know me know I'm pretty direct. If that were the intention, I would just come out and say that, Smith says when asked if it appears he is targeting the Coyotes. We're not about trying to mess with anybody else's world. I know what it's like to be in a partnership like we are in the NBA. There is a way to go about it.
Mm-hmm.
Smith maintains an open line of dialogue with NHL officials, but he's mindful not to step over any lines. I don't want to get involved with how they deliver a team. We're showing that we're ready, and that's what we're putting forward, says Smith. We talk to them frequently. They know our interest. They see what's going on. They see the value, and they're intrigued.
Well, I think Smith has become BFF with Bettman, right? And Manfred. I mean, he is out golfing with everybody. That's what you love about Ryan Smith, Larry, is he is a mover and a shaker, and he's a billionaire, deepest pockets in Utah, and he is Captain Utah. Like Captain America, he wants to do what's best for the Beehive State. Whatever it entails, he wants to make it a major league city and a major league state and bring all the sports to Salt Lake. I know Gail is leading the charge for baseball, but it's clear to me that the NHL, and we're going to get Bernsey to come in and give us the full details and all the reports and all this stuff. It's clear to me that Bettman trusts Smith and trusts Salt Lake as an NHL city, and that Ryan Smith wants to move out of downtown and take the Jazz and the new hockey team somewhere else. Now, my argument was always, don't get a relocation team. Don't get all of the crap that comes with that, all the bad payroll, a sucky team, and a franchise that wasn't born in Salt Lake. The reason why the Knights and the Kraken have great fan bases early on in their hockey lives is because it's not a relocation. So ideally, they could get an expansion team, but I think Smith's just like, give us a team ASAP. We want a team next year. They'll play in the Delta Center. They won't have to play in that 7,000-seat arena that the Coyotes are currently playing in. And then, if Arizona's ownership group gets their crap together, gets their mock-up stadium built, gets the land approved, then they can get the expansion team. I don't like that. You want an expansion team in hockey because they make you competitive right away. The way they format the draft and the expansion draft, it's like take some good players and you start fresh and you'll be good right away. And if the Coyotes ownership group is able to pull the switcheroo and have Smith take the crap and then they get the brand new team and the draft, I don't like that. But we'll get Rustin's take on that second hour, right, Larry?
Yes.
You can go read Rustin's article on it at sportsradio977.com. But I love Ryan Smith. That article you mentioned, Larry, by Ian Mendez in The Athletic goes through the history of Smith as a hockey fan in Utah. He was an L.A. Kings guy, fell in love with Gretzky, talks about the Grizzlies, the history of Olympic hockey back in 2002. And he seems to believe there's a bunch of eager hockey fans up in Salt Lake. I don't think that's necessarily true. But if you get a team, the fans will follow, and Utah's sports craze, so whether it's Major League Baseball or hockey, the fans will come. If you build it, they'll come. We know how that goes. So I praise Ryan Smith. Thank you, Larry. What do you got next?
overrated clap, clap, clap.
Okay, we got the top five relocations, Larry, of all time, according to me and you.
Yes.
Okay, let's go. Let's start with five.
Number five.
These are the worst relocations ever as far as sports franchises are concerned. Now, my list is going to be different than most people's. But I'm going to start with the Colts moving from Baltimore because Baltimore is a proud city and a Johnny U and all this stuff. And they betray Baltimore and leave. And it's, what, 40, 30-something years? Baltimore goes without a team until the Ravens show up. So that's five.
Number four
is the Browns leaving Cleveland to go replace the Ravens in Baltimore. I know the Browns were always terrible, but they were a historic team, and they had to wait a decade and a half or whatever before they got their team back, right? Number three is Oakland. Number three and two is Oakland. And it could be 3-2-1, the Raiders leaving Oakland, even though it's blessed us in our community, Larry, that the Raiders are 90 minutes away. That's got to be the number one Oakland betrayal was the Raiders leaving. Number two is probably the Warriors leaving across the bay to go to San Francisco, even though that's not considered a full relocation. You have the best franchise in basketball for the last decade in Oakland at the Oracle, and they give the middle fingers to Oakland and go to San Francisco. I mean, you can still go watch them, but it's just a kick in the groin to Oakland. And then also, obviously, the A's leaving. So Oakland, it takes up a bunch of spots. But for me, on my list, Larry,
the number one
is still the Supersonics in Seattle, because they've won an NBA championship. They were in the NBA finals like in 96 or whatever when they lost to MJF. That is a good franchise, and you'll notice a trend with a lot of these teams. Oakland, Seattle, who else did we talk about? I guess some of them are on the East Coast. You could look at L.A. when they lost the Rams. These West Coast cities who refuse to submit to the billionaires and build them new stadiums, the billionaire always is going to win. So you have to submit, Oakland, and they weren't able to do that. Seattle wasn't with the Supersonics. And I feel bad for Seattle fans because you had a history. And you won. And you had Sean Kemp, and you had Gary Payton, and you had Detlef Schrempf and everybody else. And they took your team away from you to go to little old Oklahoma City. And the next team that expands in the NBA should be, well, it should be in Vegas first, but then second should be Seattle. And I'm hoping one day we'll have Salt Lake on that list as far as receiving teams from whatever league they're going to get teams from, NHL, MLB, and heaven forbid one day maybe even the NFL.
The Sport Hole.
Sports, 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 sports.
This one's lined into the gap in right center. Ryland Charles dives, and he can't get it. That one rolls all the way to the fence. Scoring from third is Dodson. Stopping at second is Kashke. An RBI double against his old school.
All right, from Larry, how about that tough loss for Utah Tech last night? This is from the Utah Tech Trailblazers website. Utah Tech baseball dropped its fourth straight in a heartbreaking fashion as UNLV walked off with a 6-5 victory on Tuesday night at Earl E. Wilson Stadium. In the UNLV ninth, former Trailblazer and current UNLV outfielder Parker Schmidt was plunked to lead off the frame. Then, after a strikeout and an infield single, Isaac Rodriguez drove a 3-2 pitch to the gap in right center, which chased home both Rebel base runners and ended the game. The Trailblazers lost despite out-hitting UNLV 12-8, with eight of the nine Utah Tech hitters in the starting lineup collecting at least one base knock. And they're playing game two right now, I believe, Larry. See if you can find a score.
Yes.
In their midweek series. Utah Tech baseball playing better once they've reached WAC play as of late. And I was hoping they could get that game one against UNLV last night, but lost in heartbreaking fashion. Have you seen Petey recently, Larry? Look up how he's been doing.
Yes.
I meant to do that before this segment. Petey Soto, our guy from Crimson Cliffs. Anything else on that one, Lawrence? I know the softball team playing SUU this week, right?
Yes.
All right. We'll look into that as well.
Letter to the Sport Hole. You can write to the Sport Hole at 93776.
All right, letter to the Sport Hole. You can write us anytime at 750 Ridgeview Drive, St. George, Utah. 84770. It's brought to you by our good friends at Balance of Nature. Check out balanceofnature.com. Real fruit, real veggies in a capsule. Don't be one of the 9 out of 10 Americans who are losers that don't get their proper serving of fruits and veggies.
There you go. Really good.
Oh, let's see. What letter you got for me, Larry? Oh, this is from Susan. I'm sorry. I miscued you there. This is from Susan. CBS Sports just signed a multi-year WNBA deal. How do you like them apples? Caitlin Clark is going to change the league and make it a contender. The NBA most watched Final Four game ever. Caitlin Clark. Yeah, I did see that, Susan. And I think they got like 38 games on national TV next year. The team that's going to draft Caitlin, the Fever. And last year they had one. And I don't know why her other games aren't on national. Every game she plays should be on national TV. And I think it's great. I think more people will be watching. My contention was that had she just stayed one more year in college, that is the primo. That's the peak. March Madness. 20 million people watching your game, built-in fan base at Iowa. That's better than what the WNBA can provide. She's clearly going to make the WNBA better, and they're going to make them a ton of money, and the viewership is going to go up. I just was saying that. Why not come back to Iowa and try to win a national championship? That's the most eyeballs you're going to get in basketball. And I think the argument against that is for her and Angel, it's, well, I want to play against the best in the world now. I don't want to come back for another season, even though I'm making millions of dollars with Powerade, Gatorade, State Farm. Who else? Adidas? I don't know. I would have advised her to come back if I were her pop. But maybe she's bored. Maybe she's like, I've accomplished enough. And I don't want to come back and not win again, because then that tarnishes my legacy a little bit if I don't win a championship my third try. So I'm getting the heck out of here. I want to go play professional basketball, and bless her. We'll be rooting for her. And Larry, we'll be watching more WNBA basketball than we ever have because of Caitlin Clark. And the league's hoping that she's in the finals next year as a rookie. Because, that's a boon for them. Do you have anything to say, Lawrence?
No.
Pandering local poll of the day.
There you go. Really good. And it just brings your launch up to 13 there.
Right.
Instead of your usual 10.
So it's just launching
10.
A little higher.
Just launches a higher. And your spin rate was really good.
Those trees out of play.
All right. Who you got in the Masters? Right, quite. Larry, I've noticed you've more frequently been texting in your questions. I got Tony Finau. That was Finau with his swing coach, measuring his spin rate. Finau is plus 4,000, and he's a top 15, if you look at the odds, to win at Augusta. Always one of the courses where he's favored most. Finau's average finish has been 21st. And his average score -3 over his last 6 appearances at the Masters tournament. In Finau's most recent appearance at the Masters, he finished 26th after posting a score of even with a driving average of 298.8 yards. That's 24th in the field, and an 85.7% driving accuracy, 4th in the field, and 28.75 putts per round. That's 17th in the field. John Rahm, of course, captured the title in this tournament back in 2023. Tiger is plus 10,000 to win. And we saw Tiger interviewed yesterday saying he feels like he's got one more in him. And I always root for Tiger. Are you a Tiger guy, Larry?
Yes.
Scottie Scheffler has the best odds, plus 475. Rory's plus 1,100. John Rahm plus 1,200. Brooks Koepka plus 1,400. Xander Schauffele plus 1,600. I like Tony. Love Tony. And I hope Tiger's in contention. I find myself as a, you know, casual fan. Not really. I mean, I guess if Rory wins, that's a great story. I guess if one of the Live Tour guys wins, like if Rahm wins again or somebody, or Koepka, that's a big storyline. But like SVP, your boy, said when he played it a couple days ago, the Live PGA rivalry in the May, who cares? People aren't talking about it near as much. The players don't want to talk about it. They don't want it to overshadow the majors and, you know, the rivalry and who's going to do better, the Live players or the PGA players. That was kind of the case last year, if I remember. There was a lot of talk headed into the Masters last year about the Live guys. But who you got? You got Scheffler or somebody?
Yes.
You got Scheffler?
Yes.
So you're going chalk?
Yes.
What good is your robotic algorithms if you just pick? Because you had UConn, too.
Yes.
What are we paying you for? I guess we're not paying.
I'm the one that got it done and did a great job.
All right, Handyman is brought to you by Lux Ace Hardware, 3 Southern Utah locations, Santa Clara, St. George, and out to Hurricane. In fact, they're building their new location in Hurricane, 40,000 square feet. And Bucks has more than just your typical hardware store stuff. They've got books, they got toys, they've got home decor and everything else. And that new one in Hurricane is mind-boggling, all the stuff they're going to have. Team sports stuff, you need a hat, they got a hat for you. They got awesome hats. I was just in the Santa Clara location last week, and they had a bunch of sports stuff. All right, what do we got today, Larry? Oh, this is this isn't really a handyman. We kind of squoze it in for the bit, but you know, Scott Drew, the coach at Baylor, is apparently now the top target for Kentucky. And I haven't looked over the last hour and a half if there's anything new on this, but Kentucky, you know, people are saying private jet. We saw it going from Waco to Lexington and that type of thing. And then Scott Drew posted something like, no, I'm at a diner in Waco right now, implying that he's not going anywhere. And Chip Gaines, who is Joanna Gaines' husband, we all know who Chip Gaines is tweeting and stuff, getting involved. And it made me think that I'm surprised in college sports that more uber-rich dudes haven't said, look, I am going to be the face of Baylor Athletics. Chip Gaines has got $1 billion. They sell crap in Target. They have all these different lines of everything now. Can you look that up, Larry? How much are the Gaines family worth? It's got to be a lot. Hundreds of millions of dollars. And if I'm Chip Gaines, I just say, look, what collective do we have here at Baylor? It's the Bear, you know, the Bear Boys collective, and we're raising money, and we got a couple million in the kitty. We won a national title 4 or 5 years ago without NIL, but now we haven't, you know, been super competitive in this new NIL world. If I'm Gaines, I'm saying, okay, I'm taking over. I got $100 million that I'm going to invest in this program, and I'm just going to go buy the top 10 guys in college basketball to come and play for my team in Baylor. I'm going to convince clinging to not going to the NBA at UConn, I'll pay you $5 million next year. Come and play, win a championship at Baylor. I'm going to get Filipowski at Duke. I'm going to get Bronny James at USC. I'm going to pay him $3,000 to $4,000 to come and play. And I'm going to be the savior of Baylor sports, not only basketball, but football. And I'm going to be the face of Baylor, like Jerry Jones is the face of the Cowboys. I don't understand why more uber-rich celebrities who have an alma mater haven't taken this opportunity to save their teams. We know Phil Knight at Oregon's doing it. We know T-Boone. But now anybody can do it, and they don't have to go through the schools. They don't have to go through the athletic department. They can run the show themselves and be the general manager / president of their school. Like, Ryan Smith should be doing enough with the hockey stuff. Who cares? Go save BYU Athletics. Go buy a bunch of players at BYU and own BYU Athletics. The guy from, who's the guy from who writes the books? Who's the Utah alumni, Larry? Anyway, he could go be the multimillionaire guy to save Utah basketball. And every school's got somebody. Damian Lillard at Weber State. Don't just donate to the collective. Become the collective. Who's the richest Utah Tech Dixie State alumni? Can you think of anything more gratifying than going to your alma mater and just making it good? And it's instant. You can do it next year. I'm trying to think of Utah State, the kid that did Crumble. He's got $1 billion. Go be the owner of Utah State Athletics and pay the coaches to stay or whatever, right? I'm surprised more individuals haven't become the face of college sports. And it's just whatever booster club collective, you know, doing it. You understand what I'm saying, Larry?
Yes.
Any other thoughts on that one?
No.
Right. Hey, will you cut the malarkey? There's a white man talking up here.
It's time for There's a White Man Talking in the Sport Hole.
There's a White Man Talking is brought to you by Navage. all right, who do we got, Larry? Oh, we've got Colin Cowherd, right? All right, fire away. Okay, this is Cowherd about Bronny James. Speak of the devil.
Colin, the only reason he would get drafted is because his dad is LeBron. Sort of the same reason you got into law school, because your dad went there. You know how many people have asked me that I know through the years, can you get my kid an internship at Fox? Connections matter. They always have.
Now, I love Cowherd. You hear him on Fox Sports Utah 101.9. And that's out of context, because he goes on to say some other stuff. But let me just say to the idea that, hey, nepotism is everywhere. That's how you got the job. That's how you got to law school. That's how whatever. That's what we like about sports, though, is that it's not about who your dad is. Especially, we're talking about the NBA. We're not talking about 12U travel baseball. We're talking about the NBA. And the purity of the NFL and all these other places is Marcus Jeffrey Jordan tried to play and he sucked. And they said, go home to mama. We don't want you. You're not good. We don't care that your dad is the most important guy in the history of basketball. And we don't care that Walter Payton's son wanted to play football. He wasn't any good. And they said, beat it. This is a meritocracy. So the idea that we can apply how the real world works with sports. Sports is the refuge from the real world, where people do get stuff based on connections or whatever. You know, and even the fact that Danny Hurley has his son on UConn as a walk-on and Tom Izzo has his son as a walk-on, I'm not cool with that either. I know it's a cute thing and a special moment, father-son, when Izzo's son was interviewed after the Big Ten tournament or something. It was a very emotional, cool thing. Him crying, hugging his dad. Thanks for letting me walk on. Like, his son was very grateful and appreciative. But I'm just kind of like, well, there was a guy who is more deserving who wanted to play at Michigan State who didn't get it. If you want your son to be a part of the journey of your coaching career, give him a clipboard. Have him be a manager. But to throw him a roster spot, I know it's special to these coaches, but I'm not cool with it. I mean, Jim Boeheim's son played for Syracuse, but he was good. He was their best player. And that was special because it was merit-based, and he earned the spot. Doug McDermott played for his dad, right? There's tons of them. Remember the Reed twins playing at BYU back in the 90s, Larry? I can dig it, but I don't like the, oh, this is so cute that my son is the mascot of the team, and we're actually going to give him a jersey. Just give him some film. He can travel to all of the games, but make him a team manager, and then that's fine. And I'm not digging the Bronny James. Yeah, everybody does it. You know, that's how the world works. Not in sports. That's why we love sports, right, Larry?
Yes.
Who's your dad? Do you have a father?
No.
It's time for Change My Mind in the Sport Hole.
Ladies and gentlemen, the moment you've all been waiting for. In this corner.
All right, Change My Mind. This is from Larry's textual communication, right, Larry?
Yes.
How hard is it? All right, Change My Mind. All kids should be forced to play a sport for at least 1 year in their adolescence. Well, I don't know if that's needed, Larry. I think most kids do. I mean, especially in St. George, every kid's playing soccer when they're 7 years old. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Here's what I would say about the sport. Enough of the whatever. That's great. 90-something percent of kids probably do anyway without you and your crazy dictatorship, Larry. You're going to force them to play?
Yes.
Here's what I would say. I had this thought a couple weeks ago. I was at home watching March Madness with my brother. And my brother is a former wrestler. And so we had two TVs. We're watching March Madness on the other. And then on the other one, he snuck on the wrestling national championships. And we were like, what's going on? There's the tournaments on. And he said, no, we're going to watch some of this. And we watched it. We started talking about wrestling and stuff. And so let me adjust your thing, Larry, to say every American boy should be forced to wrestle. You know how some countries, like Markkanen had to go back to Finland for compulsory military service? Or like Israel does. A lot of foreign countries have, hey, you got to come after high school, you got to come back and serve in the military for a year. You spoiled brat. Come and do this for a year. The country's done a lot for you. What have you done for your country? Nothing. Come and serve. This is our equivalent of that because America could never get away with that. What you could get away with is forcing the kid to wrestle. And I am such a pansy that I didn't wrestle, and I regret it. I want my kids to wrestle, Larry. And if every kid had to commit to a wrestling season and go through the practices and the brutal workouts and getting embarrassed and getting pinned and not giving up and coming back the next day and going through all that stuff, wrestling's different, I think, than any other sport. Because you can say, oh, football's a great sport. There's teamwork and sacrifice, and football's great, basketball's great, baseball's great. There's something about wrestling where you're alone and you're going full bore for 2 minutes around, and the practices are the worst thing ever, and you've got to make weight and discipline. If every kid in America had to be a wrestler for a year, the whole country would change in a matter of like 4 years, because there would be a new determination in the... If I was a company, all I would do is hire wrestlers, because they're just that much better than everybody else. So that's how I would. I like your idea, Larry. Sports are great. Wrestling's better than all of them when it comes to that stuff. Thank you.
The Sport Hole.
Sports, 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 sports. There is, I don't think there is going to be like a single number on the stat sheet that is going to be eye-popping, especially early. It is important to kind of understand the type of player that we are about to see. This is not, you know, Aaron Judge, Pete Alonso, rookie year. Is he going to get to 50 homers? This is not what that's going to be, I don't think.
Who am I to doubt that he's, you know, that he can't, you know, grow into to even more pop, right, or closer to 30 or 40? I don't know. It's still so early, so there's no reason to really cap it. But yeah, generally, I agree with your assessment.
All right, that's the Yahoo Baseball podcast. They're talking about Jackson Holliday, who's making his MLB debut tonight, right, Larry? Later on tonight. I don't think it was a day game. Yeah, it's tonight in Fenway. Jackson Holliday, the number one prospect, Matt Holliday's son, who's fantastic. Holliday entered his senior year in high school in 2022 as a top prospect for the upcoming draft. During a game against Union High School, he hit 3 home runs. In another game, he hit 2 home runs in the same inning. He finished the season batting .685 with 17 home runs and 79 ribbies in a high school season in 40 games. He set a national record for hits in a season for an amateur player with 89, surpassing the previous record of 88 by JT Realmuto. He was named the Oklahoma Gatorade Player of the Year and all this other stuff. And he's playing tonight. I've also enjoyed watching Wyatt Langford for the Rangers, who played 1 year at Florida, and he's a 5-tool, obviously fast, hitting for power, strong, no batting gloves. I don't, is he wearing batting gloves? He doesn't run with a mitt on. So yeah, I think Jackson Holliday, I hope he does well. Root for him tonight. Thank you, Larry.
Happy, happy, happy.
All right, happy would have been, this is posthumous, happy 88th birthday today, would have been his 88th to the great John Madden. A football star in high school, Madden played one season at College of San Mateo in 1954 before he was given a football scholarship to the University of Oregon, studying pre-law and playing football with childhood friend John Robinson. Did you know any of this stuff, Larry? He was redshirted because of a knee injury and had a knee operation. Then he attended the College of San Mateo and then Grays Harbor College. And then he played at Cal Poly. So he entered the transfer portal like 5 times, John Madden. A man before his time, and we miss John. Quick break. Back with more right after this. Thanks for being with us.